Hi folks, Nathan here with the first lesson of Learn2Python, a video series designed around example-based teaching and learning for Python. My name's Nathan, and I'll be your programming guide throughout a magical journey through the land of programming. I'll talk about computer science, I'll talk about Python programming, I'll talk about how computers work, and I'll talk about kind of interesting ideas that come about because of programming. But before we get into kind of the neat and interesting stuff, I want to really talk about the structure of how these lessons are going to work. This is our main page. This is our Learn2Python main page. And you can find this page at learntodo.github.com/learn2python. And no worries, I'll have this URL in the YouTube description below. So you don't have to write it down or anything. If you like this video, if you like this series, make sure you bookmark this page because all the lectures, all the exercises, all the homework will be on here, and they'll be updated as I put them up. So as you can see, there are three major parts of the Python lessons. The first part is a lecture video, which you can see here, and the lecture video consists of what we're doing right now, talking about basic ideas, kind of general thinking, important vocab, and also I'll be working through exercises with you. And during these exercises, I want it to be interactive, so pause whenever you feel like it and try it yourself. In fact, I will tell you to pause a video and go do something by yourself, and then you can come back and watch me do it. So then we can kind of learn together. In the exercises portion, it's a separate video, and I'll be releasing it one day after the corresponding lecture. So exercises one will be released after lecture one by one day. And in these exercises video, I'll basically be giving you homework. I'll talk about concepts from the previous day, and I'll ask you to complete a certain problem. At that point, I want you to pause the video. Try the problem by yourself. If you solve it, that's great. If you can't solve it, then that's no big deal. Unpause the video, and if you continue watching, I'll work out the solution with you. And I'll have probably 4 to 5 exercises per exercises video. So that should give you kind of a little bit of reinforcement. The last bit are the lesson downloads. And in each lesson, I will compile a whole bunch of lesson material. And that includes kind of the Python programming files that I'll be using during the lesson. It will consist of a study guide that has like vocab, keywords, key exercises that I covered during the lesson. So these are just kind of good things to know. And if you want to get that, you can download it from lesson downloads. I highly recommend at least getting the study guide because that's very, very helpful, especially when you're trying to do the exercises on your own. The last thing on the webpage is contact. I know you can put comments on YouTube, but I'd really prefer if you had any constructive comments, click on this link and fill out this form, which is a comments, questions, and suggestions form. And if you have anything that you want to tell me, you know, Nathan, you're the most awesome person in the world. This video is the greatest thing that's ever happened to me. Or maybe I need help solving this programming problem. How do I solve it? I will take all of these kind of suggestions, ideas, comments, and then I'll take it and put it into the next video. You'll make every lesson better, and it'll also help me a lot in terms of how do I structure the lesson and what material should I cover. Okay, all of this paperwork aside, let's really kind of get down to what we're here for. What is Python? How do we learn Python? And everything else. As you can see, this is the Python main webpage. You can get to this webpage by either typing python.org in your address bar, or you can search Google for Python. And I'll also put a URL in the YouTube description below. So Python, as our official website tells us very plainly, is a programming language. And a programming language is most simply a language that we use to talk with our computers. Just like if I wanted to talk to someone in China, I'd have to learn Chinese. To talk to a computer, I gotta learn how to program, or I gotta learn a language at least that our computer understands. Python is one of many languages that we can use to talk to our computer effectively and quite efficiently. And in my opinion, Python is one of the most easy languages to learn, and it's also one of the most complex and robust languages that we can learn because it integrates with everything. And it's just kind of a great, fast language to use to prototype ideas. So, before we get into kind of technical talk, let's get Python on our computer first. So, find this page, go to the download section, and scroll down to the Python 3.2.3. You see there's a 2.7.3 and a 3.2.3. Make sure you click the download button for Python 3. It doesn't matter what the other numbers behind the Python 3 are. It just matters that it's Python version 3. The major difference between 2.7 or 2 and 3 is that 3 is just a newer language. It's got a whole bunch of new stuff in it, and it fixes a lot of the problems that 2 had. Most people still use 2 because it's the old kind of standard, and it's, hard to change from that. But Python 3 is the newest standard, and it's the one that everyone should be using soon. So, I'm going to be teaching you Python 3, not Python 2. So, find the correct installer for whatever operating system you have. I'm using Windows. If you're using Mac or Linux, you can get the tarball, or you can get the OS X installer or the Windows binary. It doesn't matter. Just find it and click on it. Once you have this installed, come back to the video. So right now, I want you to pause the video, find the python.org website, download and install Python 3.2.3. All right, go. All right, if you've installed everything correctly, you should see two new applications on your computer. One should be idle Python GUI, and the second should be Python command line. We're going to mostly be focusing our attention on idle Python GUI. A little bit of explanation what idle is as I open it up. Idle, it actually stands for integrated development. The L in development is the L in idle, and then environment. So in totality, it's integrated development environment for Python. And what that really means is that it's a environment in which we program in. Just like if you're writing a letter to your friend and you want to type it on a computer, you're probably going to open up Word or Notepad or Text Edit or something like that to type it in. And you can think of Word as an integrated writing environment. It is an environment that you use to write in. It has everything that you need there, all integrated into one program. It has the fonts, it has headers, it has the print function, it has all that stuff. So you can think of writing a letter to your friend as an integrated writing environment. And the same way for programmers, we develop things, we develop programs. So we call it an integrated development environment. And that's what IDLE is. It's an integrated development environment, or IDE, or IDLE, that we use to write our programs in. A piece of trivia, Python was actually named after Monty Python, the British TV show. And Idle is, or Eric Idle, I believe, was one of the co-founders of the TV show. So that's also why there's an L in Idle. Normally we call it an IDE, or an integrated development environment. Python chose to call it IDLE, an integrated development environment. All right, so pause the video, open up IDLE, and we'll get started with programming. Okay, so now you should have IDLE open, and it should look kind of like this. Make sure that you see this right here, Python 3.2.3 or 3.2 point something or 3 point something, as long as it's 3 point something. We just want to see Python 3. That's the most important part here. Aside from that, we don't care too much. So, remember I said in the beginning of the video, programming is kind of like talking to a computer. It's just like talking to a person. It's a language that we use to talk with our computer, to communicate with our computer. In the same way, we talk to a friend in China via chat. We can type to them in Chinese. We're just going to type to our computer, and it's going to be like we're chatting with our computer. So I'm going to say, hey, computer, can you do this for me? Print hello world for me, okay? Let's put an exclamation mark. And the computer says, okay, let me process that. And oh, I know what to do with it. You want me to display hello world. Wow, that's great. Our computer knows exactly what we want it to do, and it's printing hello world for us. Now, let me show you another example, and let me throw you another example before I fully explain everything. Let's try printing, my math is really bad, so I need to pick up 9 oranges at the store, and 5 apples, and 2 bananas, because, so how many fruits, I guess, do I have? Well, I can't do the math in my head, but our computer can do it because our computer is good at math. So I wanted to print out our 9 oranges, 5 apples, and 2 bananas. How many fruits are that? Is that in total? Then hit enter, and we get 16. And I think that's right. I may be wrong, but it seems like it's right. Trust the computer, I guess. So as you can see, the print command, all it does is it takes some stuff between two parentheses, and it spits out whatever is in the stuff. And note there's two differences. There's two major differences between these two print commands and how they display things differently. In the first one, I put parentheses and then quotation marks. So the hello world is between the quotation marks. And then the computer literally printed out hello world. In the computer world, or in programming world, this is called a string. And it's not only called a string, it's a very special type of string. It's called a literal string. And we don't really have to get into that right now. But all you have to remember is that things between quotation marks get processed literally by the computer. So if you want to literally print hello world, you will print hello world if it's between quotation marks. Just like if I say print 9 plus 5 plus 2 between quotation marks, what do you think happens? Does it give me the answer 16, or does it show 9 plus 5 plus 2? Well, as you can see, it shows 9 plus 5 plus 2. Now, going back up to the 9 plus 5 plus 2, you can see that if you don't have quotation marks, what happens then is that the computer treats it as an expression. And as it is an expression, the computer evaluates the expression. So you're basically telling your computer, oh, this is just some stuff I want you to process. I want you to evaluate. Give me the output of my input. In this case, I've input 9 plus 5 plus 2, and since Python understands what to do with basic math, it spits out the answer 16. Easy as pie. Now, what if I wanted Python to process something that it didn't know how to, understand? So this time I'm saying print hello world, but notice I don't have the quotation marks. What do you think it'll do? Because the computer doesn't know what hello world is. Well, if you hit enter, it says syntax error, invalid syntax. It's throwing us a problem. It's saying, hey man, you're telling me something I have no idea what you're like. You're not speaking correct language to me. I don't understand what you're saying. One thing that you have to understand with computers is that they're very, very specific with the way that you have to talk to it. If you mess up in missing a parentheses, or if you mess up by missing a quotation mark, then things can go south very quickly. It's better to make sure that you have for every open parentheses, you have a closing parentheses. For every opening quotation mark, you have a closing quotation mark. These are just things that you have to always be aware of. Otherwise, your computer will say, I don't know what you're talking about. Please rephrase. So, now I guess it's a time for an interesting thought. What if we wanted to display the equation 9 plus 5 plus 2 and the answer 16 in one line? Well, how would you go about doing this? One way would be to say, hey, computer, I want you to print literally 9 plus 5 plus 2, because that's between the quotation marks. And what I want you to say it equals to, and we put a comma here because the print statement can accept multiple parameters or inputs. And I want you to print out what 9 plus 5 plus 2 is. So do you see what I did here? In one print statement, I've combined both a literal string and expression in the same statement. Let's see what happens. What do you think will happen? Yeah, isn't that cool? We have 9 plus 5 plus 2 equals to 16 on one line. So note here again, we have the quotation marks that tell the computer that this is a literal something that literally needs to be printed. And then we also have an expression here with no quotation marks. And between the two, we have a comma. And that just lets Python know that there's more than one item that it needs to process. And what Python does is it processes both the items and displays at the same time. So I want you to pause the video right now. You should already have idle open. Play around with the print statement. What can you do? What can't you do? You know, try putting nothing between the two parentheses. Try putting no parentheses at all. Try putting like 10 things in as a parameter. So continue to play around with it for a little bit. And when you're done playing around, satisfy your curiosity, unpause the video and come back. All right, welcome back. I hope you got a little bit of practice with a print statement and understood how everything works. I hope you got all the, you know, parentheses and all the quotation marks in the right place. And hopefully you kind of understand how the Python shell works a little bit better. However, one important bit I have to talk about. Remember when I talked about the IDE, Integrated Development Environment, and how it was kind of like Word except for programming? Well, this doesn't look exactly like Word, right? What this looks like, it's more like a chat application. You type one line, the computer instantly responds one line back. You type another line, the computer instantly responds back. When we're developing code and we're programming, we want to normally type and execute more than one line of code at once. What if we want to print more than one line of stuff, right? Well, we can't do that now using the Python shell. We have to use an editor. So this is an extension of what the IDE is. And you can find the Python editor or the idle editor by going to File, New Window, and you open up another window. And this window looks like Microsoft Notepad or TextEdit if you're on a Mac. And it really fulfills the same functionality. I can type in print, hello world. And you can see how it looks almost exactly the same as a print hello world in the shell. However, if I hit enter, nothing happens. And it's because this editor on the right hand side is much more like what you're used to as a development environment or a writing environment, where you can write down all the commands you want to execute at one time and then you can run it. For example, let me print hello world, goodbye now. And you can go to click run module, and I'll save it as hello. And as you can see on the left hand side, when it runs, it prints both lines, hello world and goodbye now, at the same time in the order we have typed it. For instance, if I would have written goodbye world, goodbye now first, what do you think happens? Exactly. Yes, goodbye now displays first, as you can see. So that's the important thing to note. When you're writing code down in an editor, it always executes, for Python at least, it executes from top to bottom. So you want to write the stuff that you want to execute first at the very top, and the stuff that executes last at the very bottom. Now that we have this kind of, you know, editor, what can we do with it? Are there interesting multi-lined functions that we can start writing? Well, you bet there are. That's why I asked those questions, obviously. So if you download the lesson downloads pack, you'll find a couple of Python files inside already. And if you have downloaded it currently, go ahead, open it up. If you haven't downloaded it and you want to, also go ahead, open it up. If you don't want to download anything from my site, that's fine. You can just copy the code straight from this video, and everything will still work perfectly fine. If you have downloaded it, if you have downloaded my lesson planner, or my lesson pack rather, you'll see these two Python files, greet and greet with weather. The first thing we're going to be looking at is greet. So go ahead, open it up. When you open it to edit it, you want to right click and say edit with idle. That's very important. So right click and edit with idle, pause the video, find this Python file called greet.py, right click, edit and idle. All right, if you've opened up the right file, you should see something like this. It should say greet.py at the very top. It should say def greet name, print hello name, print how's it hanging. If you don't have it, the right file open, close it, open up the other one. There's only two, not too hard. So this is only three lines of code, but you know what? It's our first example of what a function is, and that's super exciting because we're going to be doing this all the time. Before we go any further, let's talk about what a function actually is. A function is a way for us to wrap up a whole bunch of other code into one statement. So let me run this code and show you what it does before we kind of get into it. So I hit run module, and I type in greet Nathan. And it says, hello, Nathan, how's it hanging? Wow, that's so neat. It knows my name. How does it know that? Well, let's look at the code. Let's ignore the first line because it's confusing. We don't know anything about it. Ignore the second line because it has something weird too. But the third line we understand, right? The third line is print, how's it hanging? I mean, we've done this. We did this 5 minutes ago. We totally understand. You see it here, how's it hanging? See here, how's it hanging? Print, we understand. Gotcha. This second line is a little bit more confusing, but it's not too bad. It says print hello, and then there's this name, and then there's an exclamation mark. Well, what could that be? Well, I don't know. But you can see that it says print, and it says print the hello part, and then prints name. I guess it prints my name, and then has an exclamation mark, and then prints that too. So that's not too bad. And let's look at the top part. Well, here's the interesting part. You see this name shows up between these parentheses, and the name also shows up here. And in the greet function that I typed, it said greet, and then between the parentheses, I typed my name, and then all of a sudden, what if I typed in greet Uncle Bobby Joe? What would our function do? Well, oh my gosh. It says hello, Uncle Bobby Joe. So maybe we have a better understanding of what this name is. This name is called a parameter. This actually could be any word or any variable you want. I could name this foo, and it would still work. Let me demonstrate to you. That's really cool. So what this really is, it's what we call a parameter in computer programming or computer science. It's like a variable. It holds some value that we can use later. For example, it's asking us to input a value, and in this case we're inputting our name. And in the print statement here, we're evaluating this, what this value is. Remember back then, you know, 10 minutes ago, when we were talking about the print statement, and we said we want to print 2 plus 3. Well, because there's no quotation marks, it evaluates it as an expression. And when we hit enter, it evaluates it as 5, because that's the value of what 2 plus 3 is. In the same way, the value of foo is, quotation mark, Nathan, end quotation mark. If we just typed in, say, print foo right now, or print name, what would happen? It'd be really confused, because it says, I don't know what's going on, because name doesn't make sense to me, because there's no value attached to name. If we type in print foo, we still have a very big question mark. We have no idea. It is only within this function in which foo has value. So, let's talk about kind of the syntax or the wording that we have to use to get this function to work. Like the print statement, there's a specific way to write stuff. So you see that in the first, to begin the function, what we need to do is we need to define to the computer that there's a function there. We need to say, hey computer, this is a function. So we say def. Def's just is short for define. So we say define function greet. And our function name could be anything. I just called it greet. In computer science, and whenever you're programming computers, rather, it's always better if you use nice, clear names. So when you come back to it, you don't forget what's going on. Or if someone else is reading your code, they're not completely clueless. So you say def, and then you say the name of your function, and then you say your parameters, if you have any, and then you close it. And then make sure you don't forget this colon. It's really important. In Python, the colon signifies inclusiveness. So under the colon, you see how that there's an indentation here? That's very important. When things are indented under a colon, that means that they are all under the same house. So under this function house of greet foo, we have print, two print statements. I'm now giving you a challenge. I want you to open up your own editor and write your own function. And not only do I want you to write your own function, I want you to improve on my function. How do I want you to improve? Well, I want you to write a function that greets me or greets someone and tells them what the weather's like. So as a kind of a hint of how to proceed, I want this style of line, print the weather is, and there needs to be something here, obviously, and an end parentheses. So to be clear, I want you to ask me my name and what the weather is, and I want the computer to print out hello, name, how's it hanging, and I want it to tell me a user customizable weather. I wonder how you do that. Well, that's for you to find out. Pause the video, open up your own editor, and try to write a greet function that incorporates both a name and the weather. Come back whenever you're done or if you're stuck. Hi folks, welcome back. I hope you've played around with the first challenge, and if you've completed the first challenge successfully, pat yourself on the back. If you haven't, that's no big deal. I'm here to explain my way of doing things. Programming is a little bit like math. There's lots of ways to get to the same result. So if you don't have the exact same wording I do, and if you don't have the exact same code I do, that's no big deal. In addition, just as a reminder, because it's the first video, you can access all these files from the package you can download from the website, which, again, link bottom description. All right, so our code kind of looks like this. It doesn't look any more complicated, per se, than original greet function, but let's see what it does. So let's go run our module. And this time, it's asking us to put our name and the weather. Wow, how interesting. So Nathan, and it's sunny. Oops. Wow, look. So there's our old greet function here. Hello, Nathan, how's it hanging? But then we also added the weather is sunny today. Our computer is either psychic or it did what it's or it did what we told it to do. So let's go back to our code and see what's going on. The first two lines of our function are the same as the old greet function, so that's nothing new. We added the third line here called print the weather is weather today, and that's new. But is it really new? I mean, it's not really. It's the same thing that we had here in line two. All we have is a some string, some parameter, and an ending string, just like we had here. And it performs in basically the same way. The weather is sunny today. The one thing that's basically changed, the one thing that I guess we can say was the pivot in our program, was the addition of this parameter to our function. Now, I'm aware I didn't teach you guys how to add parameters to functions yet, but this style of teaching, this style of learning, is all about self-discovery. So don't be afraid to basically play around and experiment with things. You can't break Python, and you're not going to break a computer by doing these simple scripts. So go for it. Try crazy things. Notice, perhaps, that your print command, or the print command, can print multiple values if you have a comma between them. Just like this. So perhaps our greet function can accept multiple parameters if we put a comma there. And turns out that's actually what happens. If you put a comma, then you basically create more than one parameter. And you can extend this up to as many parameters as you want. So I hope you can see what happened here. We defined a greet function. We set our first parameter, which is what we call name, and we set our second parameter, which is called weather. And then we have our colon, which indicates that everything after it lives under the house of this greet function. And then we have our print hello name, print how's it hanging, print the weather today. So I hope this is all a little bit more clear. Look out for the exercises videos that's coming out tomorrow. If you have any questions and comments, remember, let me know in the comment form. Anyways, thanks.